Have you ever wondered what the 57 stood for? I always thought it was 57 ingredients, but now that I think about it, it does seem a little excessive. Well, let's find out on this episode of Antique Bottle Stories. Let me just start by saying there is so much information out there for Heinz and this company. So feel free to fill in some of the gaps of my story by reading some of the websites I've posted below. Henry John Heinz was born in 1844 in Pennsylvania. His parents were German immigrants. When Henry was a teenager, he had already started his own garden and already had a small group of customers. By the age of 21, he had already saved enough money to buy a half interest in the brickyard that his dad owned. He worked there for a couple years too. In 1869, he and Sarah get married. They had five kids. He attended Duff's Mercantile College and learned some good business strategies. So by the age of 25, him and a buddy named L. Clarence Noble started a little business called Heinz and Noble, packaging and selling horseradish and pickles. All the stories say that this was in 1869, but I show him in the directory still working in the brickyard in 1869. And in 1870, and in 71. In 1872 is when he finally pops up as a pickle manufacturer. They did pretty well. At one point, they had over 150 employees, and they were producing 500 barrels of sauerkraut, 15,000 barrels of pickles, and 50,000 barrels of vinegar every year. But the business only lasted a few years before they were overextended, and they ended up going bankrupt in 1875. Apparently, there were a few angry creditors who had Heinz arrested twice for fraud. He was cleared, but his reputation was marred. The very next year, he tried again. This time, he borrowed $3,000 from his family. Half of it was from his wife, which he vowed to pay back. So John, his brother, and his cousin went into the next venture called F&J Heinz. He was a little bit more cautious about spending this time, and he became a little bit more clever in his marketing. The customers started recognizing the Heinz label. By the 1880s, the company had grown past the previous company with over 500 employees, and he had dozens of cucumber fields now. The company continued to grow, and the family had their arguments. So about 12 years in 1888, Heinz had paid all his debts, and he decided to buy out his other two partners, and he renamed the company H.J. Heinz Company. By the end of the 1880s, sales reached over $1 million. Can you imagine? I mean, $1 million is still considered a lot of money. Can you imagine how much more so in the 1880s? One of Heinz's brilliant ideas came during the Columbian Exposition in Chicago in 1892 and 1893. The story goes that Heinz had an elaborate booth, but it was on the second floor, and it wasn't drawing enough crowds. So he ran to the printer, and he had little coupons printed up that would give the recipient a pickle charm when they visited the Heinz booth. Thousands of these cards were given away, and supposedly Heinz was getting so much traffic that they had to stabilize the second floor supports so it wouldn't buckle. Well, this little gimmick ended up getting praised in the newspapers and magazines. He did this for several years. Here's a little chart of how the pickles progressed. The pickle charm turned into a lapel pin, and it was a popular trend with school kids around the turn of the century for them to wear them to school. Apparently, it was pretty common to see common folks just walking the shops and markets with them on as well. Isn't it funny the things that get picked up as a trend? Here's a quick list of items in someone's store in 1893. You can get 3 pounds of apple butter for 25 cents or a gallon of pickles for 30 cents. In 1889, Heinz built a very attractive Romanesque style plant, which won awards for its utility and architectural beauty. And actually, part of his marketing campaign was offering guided tours through the facility. 20,000 visitors would come through each year. This place had some unheard of employee benefits, like free manicures, an indoor gym, a swimming pool, a restaurant, a library, landscaped roof gardens, and a fully equipped hospital and dentist, and an auditorium which Heinz would have entertainers stop by for some shows. It also had a three-story stable where they tended to the delivery horses. The main attraction of this stable was that the horses were fed, watered, and brushed by electrically operated machinery. The horses even had luxuries like a foot bath and a sauna. Around this time, he saw companies struggle around him. They were cutting people's wages, which often led to violence. Heinz vowed to never reduce anyone's wages, and he never did. Heinz and his family traveled all over the world. He brought back all kinds of things, art, furniture, tapestries, and he even brought home an Egyptian mummy one time. On one trip to Florida, he brought back an 800-pound live alligator, which he put in a glass enclosure at the factory for the enjoyment of his employees. And just for fun, here's his signature on his passport in 1902. Henry's wife died of pneumonia in 1894 at age 51, leaving him and the kids devastated. He didn't remarry. A couple years later, in 1896, the company's slogan, 57 Varieties, was introduced. He had been on a train and he passed a store advertising 21 styles of shoes. Inspiration hit and he came up with 57 varieties, although by then the company was already selling more than 60 different products. One source says that he picked 57 because 5 was his lucky number and 7 was his wife's lucky number. Another source just said that he simply liked the way that 57 looked. So this 57 became plastered on everything from streetcars, train cars, and he made at least 24 10-foot-high concrete statues which he put on hillsides all over. I couldn't find any pictures of those though. By 1896, at age 52, Henry Heinz was now a multi-millionaire and he was now known as the Pickle King. Heinz is said to have treated his employees very well and he was very involved in the community. His descendants also have been involved in philanthropy and public affairs. There are also some Heinz foundations. In 1899, he acquired a pavilion in Atlantic City, which he called the Heinz Ocean Pier, where he put some of his artifact collection. This pavilion featured a huge green pickle on either side of the entrance, with a huge 57 above the entrance. This had all kinds of interesting things inside. There was paintings, a Buddhist shrine, some 9-foot elephant tusks, a chair belonging to General Grant, and of course, lots of Heinz products. 15,000 visitors came each year, and it stayed in operation until 1944, when a hurricane all but destroyed it, and the 5 from the 57 fell into the ocean. In 1900, we see in this census that his son Clarence is 27 and he's also working at the plant with him. His other son Howard is at college, but he joins in soon too. He's got about 2,800 employees now. Here are some photos from around the plant during this time. Here's an assembly line. I think these guys are putting on labels. Lots of women work in here. These guys are loading a train with goods. Here, they are wrapping cans of baked beans, and these ladies are packing pickles in jars. Heinz was one of the first of his time to use an outdoor electric sign when he erected a 6-story billboard at New York's 5th Avenue and 23rd Street. It featured a 40-foot pickle and contained 1,200 light bulbs, and it cost $90 a night to light. He had to dismantle it the following year, though, because the Flatiron Building was being erected on that site. It was 22 stories and was one of Manhattan's earliest skyscrapers. Not that Flatiron really has anything to do with this story, but it was completed in 1902, and the Flatiron is still standing. The company wasn't incorporated until 1905. Heinz obviously was the president. By 1908, Heinz becomes the world's top tomato manufacturer. He had 20 food processing plants erected by the time he died in 1919 of pneumonia at age 74. Everyone who knew him said he was a good man. He had remained involved in his church as a Sunday school teacher. He was said to secretly help employees who fell on hard times, and he just treated everyone the way he wanted to be treated. After Henry died, his son Howard Kavod Hines became president, and he remained president until his death in 1941. At that time, Howard's son, John Henry Hines II, took over as president. This is during World War II, and the Hines plant in Pittsburgh ended up being converted to produce gliders for the war effort. The Hines company also helped with food shortages during this time. Henry II remained president until 1966, where he stepped down from president, but he remained on the board until he died in 1987. Now, Henry II did have a son named Henry John Hines III, and he was just chairman of the company. He was never president, but he also served in Congress until he died in a plane crash in 1977. Now, I don't really know who all is running the company now today, but it's no longer being run by a Hines descendant. And in 2015, Hines merged with Kraft. Hines is over 150 years old today. In 1972, the factory tours stopped, since almost everything was automated now. I couldn't find a clear date on when production stopped in Pittsburgh, but now Heinz ketchup production is mainly in Ohio, pickle production is mainly in Michigan, and everything else is being produced in Iowa. The site of the old Heinz factory is now called Heinz Lofts, and like other factories that we've seen before, the factory was repurposed into cute little apartments in 2004. Aren't these so cute? I'd love to visit there. And there's a community pool, a gym, and courtyards. This is, of course, on Hines Street. There's also a Hines Terrace in Sharpsburg. Fun fact, Henry John Hines's grandmother was named Charlotte Louisa Trump, which makes Henry a second cousin, twice removed, of Donald Trump. So my bottle has a pretty wide mouth, so it's not going to be the ketchup bottle. I thought maybe chow chow, or maybe even pickles, and here's more pickles. All of these bottles look different from mine. My jar could be a mustard, or maybe more possible, mincemeat. Mincemeat seems to have lost its popularity over the years. You just don't hear about it much anymore. I don't remember if I've ever tried it. Anyways, the bottle has tons of bubbles in it, so I was thinking it was blown, but the seam goes all the way to the top, so it's gotta be early machine made. It's got an old Owens mark on the bottom. This mark was only used from 1919 to 1929. And there's a really faint 7 over here, so that would be 1927. Early on, Hines purchased a glass factory, and they manufactured all the glassware for Hines from 1885 till 1946. They installed the first Owens machines in 1910. So here's a list for anyone who might have found some old Hines bottles and want to date them. And I found a photo where someone dated some ketchup bottles for us. And here are just a couple other products and what their jars look like. And that's it for today. I'm going to leave you with a few commercials, and we'll see you next time. Thanks for watching.
Hines 57! Hines 57, you have meals to plan each day, you and Hines can make them gay.
Get together right away
with Hines 57.
Get together with delicious Hines baked beans to make this week's Hines hint, Hines Scotch beans. All you do is roll out some sausage meat, brush with egg. Then place a tablespoon of Hines baked beans in the center and shape like this. Coat with egg and breadcrumbs or oatmeal. Now pop them into a frying pan and fry for about 5 minutes on each side. And they're ready. Hines Scotch beans. Don't they look good? That rich tomato sauce makes them extra tasty. Hines baked beans are oven baked. They cost only 8 pence or a shilling.
And you know they're good because they're Hines.
Not nothing upsets a pickle lover more than a dull, soggy pickle. Pickle lovers always insist on the proud pickle, Heinz. No compromise, no shortcuts, no soggy pickle. Heinz stops at nothing to give you a pickle that tastes the way no other pickle does. Crisp, full-bodied, savory. That's what makes Heinz the proud pickle. If you were the best tasting pickle, wouldn't you be proud?
Much you don't add or what?
No thanks. I got it covered.
Heinz ketchup. It's so rich, so thick. Why waste time with anything else? Heinz. The best things come to those who wait.